The Green Wave are coming off their first season-opening shutout win since 1972, beating Richey's Southeastern Lions 52-0 last Thursday. Now, Tulane has an early season test, hosting number 17 Kansas State in week two. We catch up with head coach Jon Sumrall to preview the morning kickoff. Coming up this week, of course, you face off against Kansas State, a team you've had familiarity with even just last year. Not the most ideal matchup you had last season, but what can you take from the game against them last year when you were at Troy and bringing that over here against Tulane?
Yeah, the opponent on both sides, they know us, we know them. Tulane and Kansas State having played in 22, and then Troy and Kansas State having played in 23, we all kind of know each other. We know schematics, we know personnel. There's going to be some new things. You know, there's only a handful of guys in our 22 team that played against them. So there's going to also be some things on both sides that weren't shown schematically to maybe a strength of a personnel grouping or a player that didn't present in week one for either team. So there's going to be some new things on both sides. There is familiarity, though. I got a lot of respect for Kansas State. Chris Kleiman does a great job. He was the FCS head coach at North Dakota State and won several national titles there. And at Kansas State, they've been really, really successful.
Right. We always see with matchups like these that have the historical context, the four-word statement, block out the noise, especially with how big the matchup was in 2022. What is the message you were telling the team heading into this game?
Yeah, our message this week is just do your job. You know, nobody has to do anything on top of, like, bigger than who they are. Nobody has to be a Superman. Nobody has to be the hero. Just do your job and do it really well. Do it with great detail. Do it with great effort. And do it over and over and over again. Make the routine plays. And, a lot of times in games like this, people want to hype it up. They want to make the game bigger than life. But at the end of the day, it's just do your job and play clean, play efficient, execute at a high level.
Clean and efficient at a high level. Those three things seem to describe how your redshirt freshman quarterback, Darian Mensah, played in week one. Looking back on it, what are some of the biggest things you take away from his performance?
Yeah, Darian was just really calm, really poised, played with a lot of confidence. That's how he's practiced, you know. So it wasn't a big surprise. It was maybe a little bit of a surprise for him to go out and do it under the lights. You know, you never know how a guy is going to go perform in his first game action. And when he gets put in the spotlight, he did a tremendous job of being ready for that moment. He prepared really well, and he played just really good football. And he didn't try to play outside of himself. He tried to execute the offense and distribute the ball, manage the game at the line of scrimmage well, and lean on his teammates in certain situations. So I was really pleased for his first in-game action by how he handled himself.
10 of 12 passing, 205 yards and 2 touchdowns. But I think the biggest thing that we've seen is not just how he performed, but how his essence really oozes into the other players. Talking to Yo'Keith Brown and even Shadi Clayton Johnson, how his swag, as they say, really is emulated throughout the entire offense. What does his presence really do for the unit?
He just has a little moxie about him. You know, you wouldn't know he was a redshirt freshman that played his first college snap last week if you didn't know, if somebody didn't tell you. Because the way he carries himself, he's a natural leader. He makes other people around him better. And then the other thing we talk a lot about in our program, he celebrates other people's success. One of my favorite moments from the game Thursday night was when Ty scored his first touchdown. The first guy on the field celebrating with Ty and for Ty was Darian. That's what being a great teammate is. It's not about the individual accolades. It's about supporting your teammates and pulling for them to do well at the same time.
Right. And we've known about, you know, his presence throughout the last couple of weeks. What was your first impression of him, and how has that carried over through then?
Yeah, like I said earlier, he was just really calm. He was excited. You could tell he was ready to go. You could tell he had great energy, but he wasn't over the top. He was just who he always is. He didn't really try to change in the moment. He was consistent to who he always is and how he carries himself. And so I was surprised maybe a little bit by that, because a lot of times guys get in those moments and they feel like they have to do something extra or something more. And when you're prepared, all you have to do is be yourself.
Right, 101-yard pick six, going back to last week, is really the turning point that we all can highlight against Southeastern. But the defense really had to have a bend, don't break mentality, if you would agree with that. What do you think has to be the approach going up against a very versatile quarterback this week?
Yeah, last week, you know, the first drive, we get a three and out, but then we run into the punter. So they extends a drive, and we create a turnover at the end of that drive, which was big. The pick six going into halftime, you know, it's 14-0. The opponent has a red zone opportunity, and we get a pick six and make it 21-0. That kind of really opened the gate a little bit for us. This week, we're going to be challenged. They're a really good running football team. They got two big-time backs. Their quarterback is a tremendous athlete. Their receivers are capable. The O-line is veteran group, a lot of seniors and juniors in that group. So they're going to get, it's going to be a physical battle. They're going to run the rock. They're going to pound it. They're going to take play action shots off of it. And we have to be able to try to contain the quarterback. He's going to get some runs, but we have to limit those runs and make sure they're not explosive.
Obviously, when you go up against a team which is known for not beating itself, how do you impose the thought process or the will of forced takeaways?
Yeah, well, so going back to the concept of just do your job this week, the ball finds you when you're doing the right thing. You know, if you want to pick, be in the right position. If you want to cause a fumble, well, be in the right gap. Like, you don't have to all of a sudden go press to try to create that. That's when you usually probably do something that's not necessary or needed or within the structure of the defense. And so we do need to get a couple takeaways. You know, we had two last week. We need to get a couple in this game to have an opportunity to help ourselves score and win. And so that's going to be a big deal, is creating takeaways, creating negative plays. But you do that just by being in the right spots.
Right. And then, of course, with the quarterback's mobility, how do you really train a defensive line that wants to really get out to the quarterback and say, hey, just stay home, don't let him get outside?
Well, it's pass rush lanes. It's leveraging the ball. You have to know if you're a frontal player. You know, like a lot of times guys want to run up and behind the quarterback instead of, I call it quadrant one, quadrant two rushes, which are in front of him. Don't get behind him and around him all the time. So level off your rush, all right? And then recognizing maybe in a rush or a rush pattern or a blitz, who's around you and where your help is, or maybe where your help isn't, so you understand which leverage you have to own. And then when you get your opportunities to get your hands on him, you got to make the tackle, because he's an elusive runner, and so we have to get him to the ground. We have the opportunities to get him to the ground.
And lastly, the last couple of years, Tulane's rise and claim to fame has been the Cotton Bowl victory, but the first step to it was beating Kansas State. How much are you yourself trying to stay even keel when it comes to not overhyping it for, you know, your tenure beginning here at Tulane?
Yeah, I'm not really putting more on one game or the other. Last week was just as important to me as this week. They're all important. You only get that game one shot at each game. And so I think you can make a game bigger than it needs to be. Every game deserves the amount of respect it deserves, which is everything you have. I mean, we're giving this game everything we got, just like we gave everything we had to last week's game. And we'll do that throughout the year. It is a great opportunity. You know, a ranked team, all right, a top 20 team coming into our stadium on ESPN. It's a tremendous opportunity. You have to understand and respect and appreciate what that opportunity is. But you can't make it any different than how you prepare for any other game, because that's what you have to focus on, is just how do you play well, not all the other stuff that goes around the game.
Tulane 17-10 win at Kansas State back in 2022 brought to the Green Wave's first win against a ranked opponent in 12 years at the time.